just to kind of summarize what we have done so far in the last class, we talked about basic reason for magnetism, that is electrons, what is the reason for electrons getting magnetic moment. So that we have seen in some sense, some details were discussed. Now we are actually in a position to find out how an atom which is consisting of z number of electrons, how this atom, just one isolated atom which consists of z number of electrons, how the atom, such an atom gets the magnetic moment. If I know the number of electrons, how do I find out the atomic magnetic moment? That is the issue right now we have to address. As I told you, then we can slowly build it up and go to molecules and solids. So let us start with the basic question again to find out how do electrons contribute to the magnetic moment of an atom. So that is the question that we have to answer. So here, as I told you, without quantum mechanics, any meaningful discussion is impossible. I know that you have done some courses in quantum mechanics, something was done here also. So with the and electromagnetism, with these basic things, I am sure you will be able to manage. But if somebody feels that it is definitely not possible, then you don't have to really worry about that quantum mechanical part. But still there will be a qualitative description of all these magnetic properties will be there. But I want to make it little more rigorous, so I am actually taking a quantum mechanical route to explain how an atom which is kept in a magnetic field, how it actually responds to that magnetic field. So that is what is being done now. So what we have to do, as we have seen in the quantum mechanics lectures, we have to and as I told you, a classical treatment will not give you the magnetism information about the magnetism, a magnetization of a material. So we straight away take the quantum mechanical formalism. In the quantum mechanical formalism, as you can see, the Hamiltonian, that is the first thing to be written. The usual Hamiltonian is the kinetic energy part, which is P square by 2m plus the potential energy, which is V naught. For example, hydrogen atom, your V naught is Z is 1 there. So here that is there. Plus, when there is a magnetic field, now we are applying a magnetic field, that is a magnetic field B. The effect of the magnetic field actually is represented, it actually modifies the momentum. The momentum becomes P plus EA by C. I am using CG as units, and A, as you know, is the vector potential which is related to B. That is, B is del cross A, which you have studied in the electromagnetism course. So that mainly what is happening is when the application of the magnetic field changes the momentum to this form, and this can be expanded as shown here. That is what I told you, some derivation is here, which of course I have written all the steps, you can go through it also. So this Hamiltonian can be expanded, so you will get the normal kinetic energy term, the potential energy term, which actually is a usual Hamiltonian of an isolated hydrogen atom kind of situation. But you have three extra terms. One is this term, which is E square A square divided by 2 mc square. Then there are two terms which consists of P dot A and A dot P. Remember, P we have it's an operator, we know the form of the operator, which is minus ih del, as we have done in the class in the morning also. So I can substitute this and I can write the Hamiltonian, the total Hamiltonian of the atom in presence of the magnetic field as H. This is H naught, that is a usual Hamiltonian term, plus these two terms which are there. So I write P in terms of minus IH del, so that is what is written here, which gives you the equation number 1. Then one can actually remember, these operators are always meaningful when it is acting on a wave function, that is what is shown here. If I take del dot A and A dot del, acting on this wave function psi, you can expand this in this form and you get this result, not very difficult. And as you would have seen in the electromagnetism course, usually we take this, the divergence of A to be 0, which actually is followed in the so called Coulomb's gauge. So this simplification gives us the modified Hamiltonian in presence of the magnetic field for this atom given by this one. So this H naught, we do not have to worry about it, H naught we know the contributions. The extra contributions that are coming because of the magnetic field are, one is this term and this is the second term. So we have to worry. So if you want to find out the response of the atom to the magnetic field, we have to only worry about this term, what is the effect of this term, what is the effect of this term. These two terms actually act what is known as a perturbation. These two are perturbations to the original Hamiltonian. So original Hamiltonian, and that gets perturbed by these two terms. So basically these two terms will produce some changes in the energy. So this is done with the help of what is known as a perturbation approach. So we use, these are all time independent cases. So we have to apply a time independent perturbation to calculate what is going to happen to the energy because of this perturbation as well as this perturbation. So this is what is to be done. Once we know this contribution, then we can find out what is the effect of this magnetic field on this atom. So here we are forced to calculate these contributions through the perturbation theory, actually speaking the time independent perturbation theory, which I am sure you have studied in your MSc time. So that is, and before we go, we take the usual thing that magnetic field is assumed to be along the z axis, and you can have various ways of writing the vector potential which gives you this magnetic field along z axis. One of the standard ways of taking this A is in this manner. You can find that if I take del cross A for this, you will get B to be along the z axis. So using this substitution, I get the Hamiltonian in this form, and I know the angular momentum, which is given by r cross p. L is the orbital angular momentum, is given by r cross p, which is of course the definition from mechanics. So we can write this z component of this angular momentum, here it is the orbital angular momentum, this Lz is given by this operator, because I is coming because of this p, which actually has the form of operator. So I can write in this manner. So this L equal to r cross p, the z component is written in this manner in the Cartesian form. So this I can substitute here, then, and I know already this Bohr magneton definition, this h bar will come, that is already taken here. E h bar divided by 2 mc is the Bohr magneton which we defined in the last lecture. So the effect of this magnetic field on the Hamiltonian, the actual Hamiltonian now is the original Hamiltonian, the hydrogen Hamiltonian, plus you have this term plus another term that is here. So the as I mentioned, we have to only worry about the extra contribution to the Hamiltonian arising from the applied magnetic field. So that is only, I am calling it as delta H, that is only this term and this term. Please remember, I am not using the magnetic field symbol as H, but I am using B to avoid any confusion with the Hamiltonian symbol, which is also H. So all the magnetic fields I am taking, I am actually taking it as B, and H always stands for the Hamiltonian. So we have to worry about what is the effect of this term, what is the effect of this term. These two are the perturbations which are going to act on the original Hamiltonian of the hydrogen like atom that we are discussing. Now one can actually, before I proceed, I will show you, or I will make this statement, that the first term that you are seeing here, that is essentially which is x square plus y square term, this is the one which gives rise to the diamagnetism of the atom. We are not yet to the solid. So this is the diamagnetism of the atom, and this gives rise to the usual paramagnetism that we talk about. That is why I told you this diamagnetic response or the paramagnetic response of an atom in presence of a magnetic field is very fundamental, and it cannot be expressed purely in a classical language. It has to be done in a quantum mechanical, formal quantum mechanical sense. That is why I have taken the minimum steps which are essential, so that you get a feel of quantum mechanical feel of these two terms, how they give rise to the two different kinds of magnetic responses, namely the diamagnetism and paramagnetism. Now we have to identify these two terms separately and go ahead. This one I already showed you, that this term is the usual paramagnetic contribution, this is the diamagnetic contribution. I will take you right to the quantum mechanical aspects of this before I proceed further. In fact, today morning also we talked about the probability density. Similarly, I can also have a current density, probability current density in quantum mechanics. If I take an atom, I can find, for example, hydrogen atom. We do a three-dimensional problem there, and we usually take a spherical polar system, and you can find out the current density, the probability current density actually is related to this wave function used through this expression as shown here. I can, what I should use is here that wave functions corresponding to, as I mentioned earlier, the wave functions are all in terms of principal quantum number, orbital angular momentum quantum number L, and magnetic part ML. So psi is all represented in terms of N, L and ML. So this, if I substitute here, I can corresponding terms of J, I can find out for various states of the electron in the atom. Once if I substitute, I can show that this J vector, the components, the radial part and the theta part actually go to 0, and only what is left is this phi part. Phi part actually is in the xy plane, if you remember the coordinate system, the spherical polar system, which must have been done in the electromagnetism course. That is why I thought I should show here again. So this J phi, the only the phi part of the current density survives, and that is given by this expression. One can actually work it out if I write the expansion of this, but I am not really doing that, just wanted to give you a feel of this. So the only part or the component of the current density, that the probability current density that is going to survive, is this one. And so this can be simplified again in this manner. Again you can see that this is a probability density that we have been talking about earlier also, that is coming here. Psi NL ML mod square is nothing but a probability density. If I take the probability current density, if I multiply with the charge, electronic charge, I will get the corresponding actual current density. Like if I take the probability density, if I multiply with the charge, I will get the corresponding charge density. So here I am getting the current density, that is a phi component, is simply this one multiply with this j phi, the charge, which is minus e, then I can get the corresponding this current density and the actual current density. And if I take the corresponding this area element, the current density can be converted into the actual current. So the dI I am writing, that is over this cross sectional area of dS, which is what is written here. So the dS actually represents the cross sectional area that is seen by this current, which is moving along the phi direction or the phi cap direction of the orbital. So orbital magnetic moment is mu L, that is what we have been talking about. So this is, I can write, once I know, as you have seen in the electromagnetism course, once you have a current loop, the magnetic dipole moment associated with that loop. So now as you have a loop in the xy plane, the phi cap actually is in the xy plane. So this loop is giving rise to a dipole moment, and the current magnitude, you know, that is given by this j phi times minus e times ds, and this is enclosing an area which actually is having a radius r sin theta, because your r vector is like this. So in the xy plane, the radius that this loop is going to have is r square r sin theta. So the dipole moment is the area, which is pi r square, in this case r sin theta square, times this current, that is like telling that pi r square I. So this is giving rise to the magnetic dipole, elemental magnetic dipole moment. So that is this one. So now I substitute all these things, whatever I have obtained in earlier steps, I can get this one. And dS, you remember, dS is nothing but, dS is the area which actually is in the plane, which actually is perpendicular to the phi cap direction. So that is nothing but r, and actually dr and r d theta. So I write it as r dr d theta. So dS is substituted as r dr d theta. So this gives me the elemental contribution to the orbital magnetic moment due to this phi component of the current density that we have talked about here. It's all very fundamentally one can show from the hydrogen atom physics itself, quantum mechanics itself, that is what I am showing here. So this tells you what is the magnetic moment, elemental magnetic moment that you can give. So the classical idea of a current loop that gives rise to a magnetic moment can still be worked out, that is what we are seeing by this method. So proceeding further, I substitute, and I know this expression is, again you have seen earlier, the volume element can be written in this manner. So the ds that I have right now, which is an area element, can be written as dv divided by 2 pi, because this actually goes around a complete loop, so that your phi actually covers this entire range of 0 to 2 pi, which is a allowed range. So that gives me ds to be written in this manner. So d mu L, that is the orbital part of the elemental the angular momentum, the elemental part, that actually can be written in this manner. And remember, if I want to find out a total magnetic moment, I have to integrate it, so that this has to be integrated over the volume, and this mod square wave function integrated over the volume is actually normalized, it is 1, as we have seen today morning also. So when I substitute, I see that the angular momentum, if I take along the z axis, because now this is in the xy plane, as I mentioned, phi cap direction is, that means it is only in the xy plane. So the magnetic moment direction will be along the z axis. So when I substitute, this becomes 1, and you get minus h bar ml divided by 2m. And if you group this, these two things to be, if I put a CGS unit, there will be C, and this simply becomes minus mu ml times mu b. So what does it mean? So one can visualize an orbital magnetic moment in this manner, which actually is coming in the form of minus ml times mu b, where ml is actually justified in calling it as the magnetic orbital quantum number, that is what we have been talking about earlier. So in a very simple quantum mechanical picture also, one can see how the orbital magnetic moment arises from the kind of a Bohr picture that we have about the atom. I mean, that is a picture that we have, you talking about radius of the atomic orbit and other things. So using this picture, you are able to see that you can actually find that you can get a dipole moment something like what happens in the case of classical electromagnetism, where you have the current loop giving rise to the magnetic moment. So, with this identification, if we go back in our original Hamiltonian, this is exactly what is happening there. Such a magnetic moment which we saw just now as mu b Lz, Lz operator corresponding quantum number is ML. So, mu b times ML is the result that we are going to get, that is eigenvalue. This is interacting with the magnetic field that is applied along the z axis, that is why this appears as the Hamiltonian term. So, Lz is correspondingly ML in the eigenvalue, Lz becomes its operator when we are writing in the Hamiltonian form. So, we can easily identify that this term is nothing but the magnetic moment, the orbital part of the magnetic moment responding to the magnetic field, that is through the usual Zeeman kind of a term minus mu dot b, because already there is a minus and minus mu dot b will give you positive sign, that is what is seen here. So, you are seeing a positive term which can be easily identified as the orbital contribution of the interaction between the orbital magnetic moment and the applied magnetic field, in this case Bz, which is purely along the z axis. So, there is a justification for writing this one. So, this is the diamagnetic contribution, I am going to show this further here. So, this term I have already shown you that this is coming because of the orbital magnetic moment interacting with the applied magnetic field. So, that derivation is coming from the pure hydrogen atom quantum mechanics, very elementary quantum mechanics of hydrogen atom will give you all these ideas. Now, one can also do a classical thing that I told you earlier, even though the quantum mechanics is essential, but in many situations a pure classical method also works with certain approximations. I am going to show that here. So, if I take a classical derivation of the orbital magnetic moment that I talked about just now, we are using a very crude classical picture here, again the same kind of a current loop and so on, but no quantum mechanics here. We take a charge which is revolving around the nucleus, the usual Bohr kind of a picture. So, you have the current is given by E by T, T is a time period of this motion in the circular orbit, we are assuming the circular orbit and so on. This is nothing but 1 by T is the nu, it is E times nu. Of course, this can be written and T can be written as V 2 pi r by V, that is becoming V is a electron speed in the orbit of radius r. So, that is what is here. So, the magnetic moment can be written as mu is given by the radius, the area, that is pi r square, as I shown you earlier. It is a pure classical treatment, where here r is the radius of the orbit itself, not the spherical polar radius here. Here it is actual radius of the, that is why there is no r sin theta here. So, pi r square times the current which is written here. If I substitute here, I can get E V r divided by 2, and remember m times v times r is actually the angular momentum, the magnitude. So, I can use, I can convert this E V r in terms of this angular momentum. I will write V r, I will write it as L by m, L is angular momentum. So, I take it as E L divided by 2 m. So, this becomes E by 2 m times L. Again, you can see the angular momentum coming into picture, not as sophisticated as you see in the case of a quantum mechanical derivation, but still it works. L is orbital angular momentum quantum number, V is electron speed. Now, the allowed values of L, as I told you, quantum theory or quantum mechanics clearly show the allowed values of L are square root of L into L plus 1, because the eigenvalue of L square operator is, the eigenvalues are L into L plus 1. So, L eigenvalues are L into L plus 1 h bar. So, when I substitute, I get this one. This is what we have seen earlier. Classical electromagnetic picture also gives you this idea about this magnetic moment, orbital magnetic moment of the atom. That is what you are seeing here, which is shown little more sophisticated manner in the earlier quantum mechanical picture. Similarly, one can also have a spin magnetic moment, as I told you earlier, which spin is generating lot of interest in you as the questions tell. So, I told you that the magnetic moment is given by G times this gamma is a gyromagnetic ratio, which is E by 2 mc in the CGS units. Yes, the eigenvalues of S operator are S into S plus 1 h bar. So, I can substitute, I already shown this, I will get this one. So, basically when you have an atom, an electron in an atom, you have magnetic contribution coming from the spin magnetic moment and orbital contribution as shown here. And of course, I showed you that a pure spin will give you one Bohr magneton. So, these two will interact with the magnetic field. So, when I write the extra term in the Hamiltonian, extra terms in the Hamiltonian, so this is the original term that we talked about. Of course, we are assuming that B to be along z axis, and then the two terms that are coming. This S is coming suddenly, the 2S is coming suddenly, because that is not coming originally, but now we are inserting this one because we know that the way the orbital angular momentum and orbital magnetic moment interact with the magnetic field, there is additional contribution coming from the spin that is not directly coming from our derivation, but that has to be inserted physically separately. That is what is done here. Earlier this plus 2s was not there, now we are physically adding it in the light of this picture that we have regarding the spin magnetic moment. So this is separately put in, added, and now this becomes the extra contribution as far as an atom is concerned, which is interacting with the applied magnetic field. Now we are in a position to find out what is the energy shift due to this one, what is energy shift due to this one. For that, as I mentioned, we use a first order perturbation theory. First order perturbation theory is simple in the sense that what you are actually calculating is only the expectation value of these particular extra operators. So here, if I want to find out the energy change, I simply calculate, as we have done in the morning today, find out the expectation value of x or px, exactly same thing is there. So I write psi star, only thing is that we use this way of writing it here in this bracket form, I will not go into the details. So this basically tells you that psi star, this operator and psi, so that is, they are all operators, so that is what is shown here. And similarly, this term also treated under the first order correction that very simple. So this gives you the corresponding shift in the energy, that is called the diamagnetic shift, and this is the paramagnetic shift, which I am going to call as a Curie paramagnetic shift. And this one here, delta E1 superscript 1, stands for the first order correction, because I can actually do a second order correction or a higher order correction to these terms, but I will not do. A first order correction is enough for us right now. So that one, this one stands for the first order correction, which actually simplifies to calculating the expectation value of these extra terms in the Hamiltonian. So it is as simple as what we calculated in the morning regarding the expectation value of x. So this is the diamagnetic contribution and this is the paramagnetic contribution to the atom when it is subjected to the magnetic field B. I will first take the case where all orbitals are completely filled. I am going to take a situation where the atom has orbitals and all the orbitals are completely filled. In such a case, one can show that the contribution from this will be 0, because when I do this, corresponding to this and corresponding to this, the total orbital angular momentum and total spin angular momentum will be 0 for that case, which means that this term will not survive. So it is easy, if I want to recognize this particular term only, you have to go to a situation where I have absolutely no contribution coming from the second term. That is realized in a situation where all the shells of the atom are completely filled. So when you have such situations, like for example inert gases, all of them are completely filled, then you have no contribution coming from the second term and everything is coming from the first term. So my delta E1 is simply the first term. When I substitute, I get this one. And remember, for a closed shell xyz, there is a symmetry as far as an isolated atom is concerned. So this can be rearranged, x square, and this has to be done for all the electrons of the atom. Or if a given atom, there are various, z number of electrons, so all of them must be taken into account. So this summation that is shown here, or this i's that are shown here, they are for all the electrons of the particular atom. So that is what is written here. So this can be written, I know that there is a symmetry and x, y, z, there is no particular preference for x, y or z. So I can write x square plus y square for any I value, I can write it as 2/3 of your r square. So that is what is written here, because always it is convenient to write in terms of r. So that is why the x square plus y square, I will not proceed further, but I will write, because 1/3 is of r square is for this x and 1/3 is for y. So that is why you get a 2/3 of contribution that is coming here. So I can find out, if I take this contribution, I have to do this summation over all the electrons. That is again difficult. So what I will do is, I will take an average value, that is I will calculate the expectation value. If I use a quantum mechanical language, I use the expectation value of r square, so that serves as an average quantity, and instead of calculating for every electron which are situated at different r values, I have an R value, the expectation value of this R square, the mean value of R square is known. So, I take this mean value and multiply with the number of electrons. Instead of calculating for every R square for every electron, I will simply calculate the total number of electrons Z and I simply multiply with the average R square value. Average R square value is nothing but my expectation value of R square. That is why this term will be replaced by the Z times R square, and R square expectation value is something which is a good quantity as far as quantum mechanics is concerned. So, you can see I substitute this for here this one and I get this expression. So, delta E diamagnetic, that is the diamagnetic energy shift, is in a case of a completely filled orbit is given by this one. You can see it is square proportional to the square of the magnetic field. Now, I will specifically talk about diamagnetism. Here I was little clever in the sense that I took a very special case of an atom where all the orbitals are completely filled or the shells are completely filled. That does not mean that diamagnetism is there only in such a case. You have diamagnetism in any shell when there is an electron, whether it is completely filled or not, diamagnetism is always there. Every electron in an orbit exhibits diamagnetism. But the problem is, if the shell is not completely filled, what is going to happen is you have the contribution from the diamagnetism and there is a contribution from the second term, that is the paramagnetism. Since I wanted to completely isolate the diamagnetic contribution, I took a case where there is absolutely no paramagnetic contribution. That is why I took that completely filled case. So, that you should not think that diamagnetism can happen only in such a case. No, the answer is every orbit, when there is an electron, there is diamagnetism, that is what is written in the first line. This contribution is always present in all unpaired orbitals, but there is a competition between paramagnetism and diamagnetism. That is why one has to be careful. So, you have both these things coming in general, but if you have a completely filled shell, you have to worry about only the diamagnetism that we are talking about. Magnetic moments are induced by the applied magnetic field, but here the induced magnetic field is opposite to the applied magnetic field, that is why it is called diamagnetism. That is, one can actually have a classical picture using the Faraday's law, which I will show you very soon. And this response when happens for a solid, right now we are talked about for an atom, if this happens for a solid, it gives rise to a bulk property, namely the diamagnetic susceptibility. Susceptibility we have defined in the last class. You have a diamagnetic susceptibility, that is something which actually opposes the magnetic field that you apply. However, the diamagnetic susceptibilities are very, very small. That is a negative response to the of the solid to the applied magnetic field in general is very, very small, as reflected by the very small diamagnetic susceptibility values, much smaller than 1. If it is 1, that tells you that whatever you are applied, the magnetic field strength, exactly it will be cancelled by the produced or induced magnetic field that is on the diamagnetic substance. But that generally does not happen. An exact cancellation or exact competition can happen only in one type of materials. They are called type 1 superconductors, which of course has been introduced to you. These type 1 superconductors, they have exactly minus 1 value. That means if I apply a 5 units of magnetic field, the response is also exactly minus 5. So, in the usual diamagnetic materials that we talk in magnetism, the susceptibility values are much, much smaller compared to 1. So, the connection to between superconductivity and magnetism will be clear as we go along with our lectures in superconductivity also. So, diamagnetism that way is a phenomenon which is there for every orbit, whether it is completely filled or not. This is the first point one has to keep in mind. So, diamagnetic susceptibility one can do. What we have is an energy shift. If I take this second derivative of this with respect to the, of course, there is a minus sign, I will go into the not the details, second derivative with respect to B Z. So, you can actually find, you get the susceptibility which is given by this. You can see it is actually determined by the number of electrons, that is a positive, and there is a negative term here, I should put a negative here. So, this R square is expectation value of this R square calculated for the atom, and Z is a number of electrons. So, this is actually the diamagnetic susceptibility part. Now, just to give you an idea, especially again you had some discussion on the classical electromagnetism, I thought I should depend on that to show you that here also a purely classical idea can give you some information regarding the diamagnetic susceptibility. We don't use any quantum mechanics, we use a simple electromagnetism, and you can get this idea. How is it done? So we do this one. So consider an atom in a circular orbit, again like the Bohr orbit of radius r. Let us take radius r. I apply my this condition that del cross E is minus dB by dt. What is this? This is your Faraday's law, because basically flux change. I take a constant area, so this flux essentially becomes B. So del cross E is minus dB by dt, and this can be written as I can actually convert this into a line integral. So it becomes, this you would have done in the other course, it becomes E dot dl is minus dB by dt dot ds. This is a flux, B dot ds is a magnetic flux. So this can be written, if I take the circular loop and over that area the magnetic field is constant, I can write this as 2 pi r times E. I am expanding this E dot dl term here, and this I can write it as minus pi r square dB by dt. I am putting a C to make it in the CGS units. So that is what is done here. So this becomes an area element, this converts into area element, here also an area element. So I can equate the two, so that gives me this expression, and this gives me an electric field that is produced at the circular orbital due to the changing magnetic field. That is what is written here. This is nothing but your Faraday's law, this one stated in a different way. So when a magnetic field is changing, as represented time rate of change of magnetic field, that is what happens in the Faraday's law, dB by dt gives rise to an induced electric field that you have studied in the other course. The induced electric field in a circular orbit of radius is what is given by this expression. I am not using the vector sign here, looking only at the magnitudes. So the induced electric field produced by the changing magnetic field is what is represented by this equation. Now what is going to happen is, you are having an electron. Let us take a particle picture, which is not really true in the quantum mechanical sense, but in a classical picture it is fine, Bohr picture it is fine. So we are having this electron in the orbit of radius r. Now this is subjected to this induced electric field E. So what is going to happen is, it is going to have a torque. This is going to produce a torque. So that means there will be a force and a torque about the center of this orbit. The torque is actually written as d tau is r cross f, r cross f, where f is a force which is given by the charge times the electric field. So r cross E times E. So this gives me the torque that is going to happen over a time interval of dt. That is what is written here. So the induced electric field produces a torque on the electron, and as you know, a torque actually is going to produce a change in the angular momentum. The connection between the torque and angular momentum is known from mechanics. So the change in the torque that is happening, or the application of the torque by the induced electric field, is going to change the angular momentum of the electron in the circular orbit, and the change is going to happen. So the angular momentum is going to change, and the torque is going to happen, that is torque that is going to be applied over a time t is tau. That is the integration of this one, that gives me this expression. Very simple to integrate, that the torque that is produced is E r square divided by B divided by 2 C in CGS units. So what happened is, you change the magnetic field, it has produced an electric field, induced electric field. Induced electric field produces a force and a torque on the electron. This torque that is given by this expression is going to change the angular momentum, and the angular momentum change can be related like this. The dl is a change in the angular momentum given by this, because rate of change of angular momentum is nothing but the torque, we know from mechanics. So that is given by this one. So correspondingly, when the angular momentum changes, now we know that it is going to change the magnetic moment, because the connection between the two is a gyromagnetic ratio. So corresponding change in the magnetic moment is d mu, which of course will be this multiplied by the factor E by 2 mc. That is the gyromagnetic ratio. Already there is a C, that is why this becomes C square. So this is the change in the magnetic moment due to the applied magnetic field felt because of the induced electric field, the Faraday's law. That is why whenever we classically talk about diamagnetism, we always bring in Faraday's law, and associated with Faraday's law, you always have the Lenz's law, which actually produces the negative sign, and which actually goes down and shows you the negative susceptibility. So this gives me my the change in the magnetic moment, that is this one. So this is a purely a Faraday effect, classically speaking, that comes here, and considering all the electrons, one has to replace your r square with z times r square. So this contribution for the entire atom becomes, and as usual we have we can write in terms of x square plus y square is in terms of r square. You can see you get exactly same expression what you get in a quantum mechanical description for the diamagnetic susceptibility. So what is done here is I find out the magnetic moment. I take the magnetization, which is nothing but the total magnetic moment divided by the volume, that is why V comes here, and this is differentiated with respect to the magnetic field, as I told you, M by H, but H in this case we are using only V. So that differential with respect to V gives you the susceptibility. Here is a diamagnetic susceptibility given by this expression. If you put a proper sign, it will be negative. So you have E square Z R square divided by 6 mc square. This is exactly same expression we got earlier when we use a proper quantum mechanical treatment. So that is what, even if you use a classical picture with certain approximations, certain assumptions, you can get the identical expressions in some situations. You are lucky to have some situations of this kind. Here is one, and since you have been talking, I mean, you have seen the classical electromagnetism earlier, I thought I should give you this one. In fact, this is the explanation most of the people give when we ask how do you explain diamagnetism. So the diamagnetism effect can be discussed in a very simple manner if you are ready to make certain assumptions, and one can use a pure classical electromagnetism argument involving Faraday's law and Lenz's law. You have to need to know only the basic Maxwell's equations, divergence, curl of various things, Faraday's law. One can substitute and you can get an expression for the susceptibility of a solid. Susceptibility is not for an atom, it is for the solid, one can get this expression. So this is a very important step, because this treatment also gives you an idea about the diamagnetic susceptibility without using any wave function, without using any quantum mechanics. But this is not a correct method, I should mention that again. That is why I started with a very general treatment of magnetic response of any atom kept in a magnetic field. That is the correct treatment, but one can actually, having done that, one can really get some information about how much or how far one can go if you use a purely classical treatment. That is what is shown by this derivation. As I mentioned, diamagnetic susceptibilities are very small for usual materials. You can see that these are SI units, standard SI units. The values are 10 to the power of minus 11, minus 10 and so on, very, very small compared to 1, as I mentioned. And this, of course, this is ZF, do not worry about defective, essentially you treat it as the number of electrons. So as I told you, the expression contains Z times R square, that is why it is plotted as a function of Z times R square. When this is more, the diamagnetic susceptibility tends to be larger and larger. So this is an experimental verification of this relationship, which is derived both quantum mechanically and using pure classical electromagnetism. Now we will go to the other term, the second term. That means the second term survives only if there are unpaired electrons in the orbital. If it is, everything is paired, if it is complete, then we have seen that you have the contribution only from diamagnetism. So now we are making it little general. We want to see what happens when you have a general shell, we do not know whether it is completely filled or not. Let us assume that you have unpaired electrons. So unpaired electrons are there in an atom. In such a case, you have permanent magnetic moment. So the diamagnetic moment is there only when you apply the magnetic field, otherwise no. But here, this is an intrinsic property of the atom. There are unpaired electrons, there is an intrinsic magnetic moment which is called a paramagnetic moment. The unpaired electrons should be present especially in one of the inner shells. I will come to that details little later. You can have unpaired electrons, let us take sodium atom, you have one unpaired electron in the outermost shell, but as far as you are talking about a single atom, it is fine. But usually these things are extended to a solid. When it becomes a solid, if the unpaired electron is in the outermost shell, it does not really contribute to a paramagnetism of the kind what we are talking about. So the, if you want to have paramagnetism, atomic paramagnetism, you should have unpaired electron, that means not completely filled shells in inner case. Now this inner shell, some of the inner shells must be incompletely filled. Fortunately in the periodic table, this happens in mainly two different series. One is actually the transition metal series, which actually is a D series. You have 3D, 4D and 5D in the middle of the periodic table, and also in the lanthanides and actinides, which are the two rows below the periodic table, where you see where you have the 4F and the 5F. Mostly we talk about 4F elements. So in that d electrons, the d orbitals are not completely filled, whereas in the f atoms, f shells are not completely filled. So you have a incompletely filled 3D shell in the case of iron, cobalt and nickel, and similarly for the rare earths, you have 4 of orbitals which are incompletely filled. These are the two cases where you can definitely expect intrinsic permanent atomic magnetic moment arising from the unpaired electrons that are present in those orbitals, as we are going to see very soon. This paramagnetism, I am going to call it as Curie paramagnetism. The atoms must have at least one unpaired electron. The magnetic moment is permanent, as I mentioned. Susceptibility is positive, not the, like the negative diamagnetic susceptibility. The susceptibility now is positive, but again it is small. Susceptibility is small, and the examples are transition metal ions, as I mentioned, transition metal atoms also in some sense we can use, lanthanide ions, that is rare earth ions, isolated ion you can take, hydrogen atom, simplest example is hydrogen atom, oxygen atom and oxygen molecule. Both oxygen atom and oxygen molecule interestingly are paramagnets, whereas hydrogen molecule is not. I will come to that very soon. So the examples also, please note the difference, it actually tells you some important information. Transitional metal ions, isolated ions, lanthanides, lanthanide ions, for example Fe2 plus, Fe3 plus, those kind of atoms, ions, hydrogen atom, not ion, it is in the atomic form, oxygen atom and oxygen molecule, they are the standard examples of paramagnetism where you have permanent moments. I want to find out a situation where I have 2 electrons. I am taking a 3D shell. I want to find out if I have 2 electrons unpaired, that is I have only 2 electrons. I want to find out what is the magnetic moment of that particular atom. I know what happens when I have 1 electron. 1 electron contribution we have already found out. I have to find out what is orbital part, what is a spin part, I know that. I know through the G factor. Now I have 2 unpaired electrons in the one of the inner shells, namely the D shell. So that is what I am taking, 3D2. 3D2 means I have 2 electrons in the 3D shell. 3D shell is what is shown here. If you remember, L value corresponding to a D shell is actually 2, and correspondingly ML values there are 5. As I mentioned in the last class, the values are 2, 1, 0, minus 1 and minus 2. So they are shown as 5 boxes here. Now the question is, at what is shown here is the electron moments are shown here. To find out what is the actual magnetic moment of the ground state, we are always initially we are interested only in the ground state, that is the lowest energy situation, what is the magnetic moment of this particular atom, that is what is to be found out. For that there are a set of rules given by Hund's, that is called Hund's rule, and only that one can give you a simple idea or simple estimate of the magnetic moment in the ground state. I will demonstrate with this example. When I have 2 electrons, this can be extended when you have more number of electrons also, the 3D. So what you have to do is, you have to put the first electron with the highest ML value. That means I can't start anywhere here, the first electron must come here, and it has to be an up spin. The second electron has to go to the next one where the ML value is just lower than this, because I can put one more electron here, actually speaking, because I can put a, this is an up spin electron, up arrow represents an up spin electron, as I mentioned in the morning. I cannot put another up spin electron here because that will violate the Pauli's principle, exclusion principle will be violated if I put here, because then you will have orbital quantum number, principal quantum number, spin quantum number, everything will be the same, and that cannot happen for 2 electrons. So I cannot have an up spin in this 2 box. So if I want, I can only put this up spin in the next one. So what is to be done is, the rule tells, first of all you should try to make all the spins to be in the same direction. That means if first is up, you put everything up. So that is to be done without violating the Pauli's principle. That means this cannot come here, it has to go to the next one. So you have to maximize this ML value, and so that you put it in this manner, and then you have to have this condition satisfied. So that gives me 2 new quantum numbers, which is L, which actually is a summation of the ML value of this and the ML value of this. In this case 2 plus 1, that gives me 3. And similarly, I have an S value, new quantum number, that is, I mean, again summation of this plus this. This arrow represents MS, always an upspin arrow is a plus MS half, the other thing is minus MS half is minus half. So, this is plus half, this is plus half, when I add the 2, I will get 1. So, I have J, so I have an S, L quantum number and S quantum number for the 2 electron system where this atom has a 3D2 configuration. So, I have L value and S value. Remember, L and S basically they represent the angular momentum as we have been seeing. The symbols are, I mean, changing from small letters to capital letters, but otherwise they have the same physical meaning because now it is a 2 electron system, not a single electron system. So, I have L and S, both represent corresponding angular momenta. So, you have L getting as 3 and S getting as 1. Now, as we have seen, J is a result of this interaction between the spin and orbital, and as I showed you, the J, vector J equal to vector L plus vector S can give you many values starting from L plus S to L minus S as mentioned earlier. So, the rule is your ground state will be J equal to L minus S when your number of electrons is less than 5 in the case of D electrons. So, that means up to 5, that means this is completely half filled case. So, when the number is less than half filled, for example, if it is 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5, your J resultant, the ground state J value will be given by L minus S. If it is 6, 7, 8, 9 or 10, of course, 10 is extreme, you will see that the ground state is given by J equal to L plus S. So, you have J L minus S as the ground state in one case, that is when the shell is less than half filled. When it is more than half filled, the ground state J is given by L plus S. Remember, J, L, S are all here quantum numbers, not operators, not vectors. So, and I know J, L, S and J, I can find out my G. If I substitute, in this case, it works out to be 2 by 3. So, I have J value, I have my G value, I can find out what is the total magnetic moment. The Z component I can easily find out, that is given by G times, this actually is mu Z. Z component is G times J times mu B. So, that when I substitute, I see that it is 4 by 3 Bohr magneton. This is the magnetic moment which is intrinsically there without applying any magnetic field, just because you have 2 electrons and that is in an unpaired shell, I mean in an incompletely filled shell, this gives rise to the magnetic moment of 4 by 3 Bohr magneton. So, what does it mean? Just because you know that how to calculate the electronic magnetic moment, it is not very straightforward to find out how an atom which has a certain number of electrons, what will be the atomic contribution to the magnetic moment. You have to find, if you want to find out the ground state magnetic moment, you have to really go through the Hund's rule, Hund's rules, because there are 3 rules. As you are seeing, you are actually trying to maximize your MS or S, you are trying to maximize your ML or L, and then the rule tells what is your J value, that is the third rule, that gives you what is a ground state magnetic moment. So, this actually tells you, the Hund's rule gives you an estimate of the ground state magnetic moment of an atom. It is very, very important. This is not for the solid. All my discussion right now is for a single isolated atom where the 3D shell has incompletely filled situation. In this case, I have 2 electrons only. If it is 10, then it is completely filled. If it is completely filled, as we have seen, it does not have any intrinsic paramagnetism, it has only a diamagnetism as we have seen earlier. When you have a number less than the completely filled case, like 2, 1, 3, 5, 7, you have a magnetic moment that is coming from the atom, it's purely an intrinsic property, that and the Hund's rule gives you that value. Remember, it is only the ground state magnetic moment of an isolated atom. Do not just jump and try to calculate the magnetic moment just by drawing these boxes using the Hund's rule. That in general, it is not expected to be correct if you are talking about solids and other things. If it is only an isolated atom, this rule works and it gives you the correct intrinsic magnetic moment, the so called Curie paramagnetic moment that I have been talking about. One can have other examples also. As an exercise, you can try what happens, interesting to see what happens when I have 5 electrons. 5 is a half filled situation because 10 is maximum, 5 means you will have here. So, 5 will allow you to put all of them to be up without violating the Pauli's principle. You can put all of them here, but what you are seeing is that at that time there will be no orbital contribution. Your L will become 0 because all the negative sides and positive sides will be 0. I'm adding together, you will have a pure spin moment as we have seen sometime earlier. It will be a pure spin case. So, please try to work out one or two more examples like a 3D 4 configuration and 3D 5 configuration using the same principles. Something connected with this, not exactly connected with the paramagnetism, but it is of interest to discuss at this point. So, now it is very clear that any atom, if it has got unpaired electrons in the, especially in the inner shells, definitely there is an intrinsic magnetic moment. This has nothing to do with the applied magnetic field. There is no applied magnetic field. This is intrinsic property. Whereas diamagnetism is not intrinsic, you have to have an applied magnetic field, then the response is there, magnetic field is removed, it has gone back. There is no intrinsic, there is nothing like a diamagnetic moment which is going to stay permanently there. Whereas if you have unpaired electrons in some shells, especially inner shells, you have a permanent moment, atom has a magnetic moment. So, this is clear very much now. There are various experiments which actually show that this is true. The atom has a magnetic moment has been demonstrated with the help of various experiments. I will not go into those details of those experiments, but I just wanted to talk about one case which actually is interesting in more than one sense. That is what actually such an atom which has got a magnetic moment, I am going to put it in a magnetic field. That is what is happening here. This is probably you have heard about it. This is a famous Larmor precession. Larmor precession happens because the first thing is it has got a magnetic moment, the atom has a magnetic moment. And I just one isolated atom has a magnetic moment, only if it has a magnetic moment, intrinsic moment, it undergoes the Larmor precession. When does the Larmor precession happen? You have this atom which has got a magnetic moment, as shown by this L vector. This is representing the angular momentum, or as actually represents the magnetic moment, as I told you earlier, because electronic charge is negative, the angular momentum is like this, magnetic moment is exactly in the opposite direction. Do not worry about that. Right now, you can take them to be in the same direction for our argument. Such an atom is kept in a magnetic field. The magnetic field, as usual, we have taken to be along the z axis. What is going to happen? Remember, the z axis is our axis of quantization, and I have already shown that. When you tell that the magnetic moment is kept in a magnetic field, the L vector cannot align along the z axis. This is true when the magnetic field is present also. That means there is always going to be an angle between the applied magnetic field along the z axis and the orientation of the magnetic moment or the angular momentum. In this case, I am not distinguishing between the two. So, there is an angle, that is what is shown. The angle, this is the magnetic field along the z axis, and there is an angle, that is a semi-vertex angle of this cone that you are seeing. I will come to the cone. Assume that this is a magnetic moment and there is an angle between the two. When there is an angle between the angular momentum or the magnetic moment and the magnetic field, naturally there is a torque. That torque is mu cross B, that is tau is mu cross B. So, what happens when the torque is there, this magnetic moment has to, so because this torque will produce an angular momentum change, but this is an atom and the angular momentum, this L originally, and remember what is the direction of the torque? This is a cross product. The angular, the torque direction will be along the direction which is perpendicular to the plane containing mu and B. Mu is in this direction, B is in this direction. So, the plane containing mu and B, mu is L actually, is this one, and hence the torque will be in a direction which is perpendicular to this. And remember, this magnitude of this L cannot change, but now the torque has to do some job. What is the job it can do without changing the length of this vector? Changing the length of the vector is changing the angular momentum magnitude, which is not possible. So, what happens? This vector L is changed by this delta L, or this goes on, and hence this L vector essentially precesses about the z axis
or is about the magnetic field axis like this. It's a classical picture, but is important. Because of the fact that there is an angle, originally there is an angle between the magnetic field or the z axis and the magnetic moment, atomic magnetic moment. When you apply the magnetic field itself, a torque is produced, and this torque is going to make this L vector precess about the field direction. This goes on like this, and I have written all the steps here. I am not going to the details here. It's one can actually work it out, not it's actually self-explanatory. One can see that this precession frequency, this is going to go like this about the magnetic field axis. This precession frequency actually is calculated to be E times B divided by 2mc in the CGS units. This frequency is called a Larmor precession frequency. Whenever you have a magnetic moment of an atom and if you apply a magnetic field, you get Larmor precession, and this Larmor precession is very important. This gives rise to techniques like electron spin resonance or your nuclear magnetic resonance, which we talked about in the case of MRI. Instead of having atomic magnetic moment, if I take the nuclear magnetic moment, if this L vector or the mu vector that I am talking about is corresponding to the nucleus, all the things that I am talking about here will be true when I apply a magnetic field. The nuclear magnetic moment, only difference is instead of atomic magnetic moment that I am talking about now, the nuclear magnetic moment at that time will precess about the magnetic field, and that is the basic idea behind this nuclear magnetic resonance technique. So what happens is when this is precessing with this kind of frequencies, if you apply external frequencies, electromagnetic field having that correct frequency, there can be energy absorption, energy exchange between the system and you, the source, and this is giving rise to electron spin resonance in the case of atomic magnetic moments and nuclear magnetic resonance in the case of nuclear moments, that is NMR nuclei. So you will be using, and you can see the mass in the Larmor precession frequency, mass is in the denominator. Here it's mass of the atom. So in here, if I talk about here, this is the mass of the electron if I have one electron, otherwise the number of electrons. If I talk about the nuclear magnetic resonance, the M will be mass of the nucleons, which will be much larger. The Larmor precession frequency given by this expression, even though the form is the same, the Larmor precession frequency for an electron is much larger. It is almost 2000 times larger compared to the Larmor precession frequency of the nuclear moments when the same magnetic field is applied in both the cases. So you have precession frequencies different in the case of electron moment and the nuclear moment. So one case you will have one set of frequencies, in the other case you use much lower frequencies. In the case of nuclear, you will use much lower frequencies, the RF frequencies. This is what actually is used for energy exchange, absorption and emission between the system, that is system which actually produces the electromagnetic waves, and the nuclear system or the atomic system, the electronic system. And this exchange is what is actually used in the case of these resonance techniques or magnetic resonance techniques, both in the case of ESR and NMR. In fact, ESR, electron spin resonance, is also called electron paramagnetic resonance or EPR. That is why I am just putting it here, since we are discussing paramagnetism. So electron paramagnetic resonance and electron spin resonance, they mean the same. And the corresponding thing for the nuclear moments is called the nuclear magnetic resonance, which actually is the fundamental thing in the case of MRI, magnetic resonance imaging. Both are magnetic resonance. What is a resonance? The magnetic moments actually, which are undergoing the precession in presence of a magnetic field, they are able to have a resonance absorption or emission with the external agency, which is nothing but the electric field, oscillating electric field generator. So that is what is used in these both the techniques, which are very important today. So this essentially tells, now we get a somewhat a clear picture of what happens when I have an atom, under what condition the atom has a permanent dipole moment, the so called Curie paramagnetic moment, under what condition I can expect only a diamagnetic thing, that means not permanent, not intrinsic, and in general if I have unpaired electrons, I can expect both, because diamagnetism will always be there whether the number of electrons is 1, 2, 3 or whatever it is. So the diamagnetic response will always be there, but if I have unpaired electrons, the paramagnetic effect will be much larger, much stronger, so you do not essentially feel the diamagnetism. That is the only difference. That is why if you want to look at diamagnetism, you have to look at a case where there is absolutely no paramagnetic intrinsic contribution, which can be seen only when all the shells are completely filled. In any other case, seeing diamagnetism, probing diamagnetism will be difficult because you have a much stronger positive contribution. So, seeing this negative contribution, which is very feeble, will be difficult. So, if the other contribution, the positive contribution is 0, then whatever small value you have for the negative thing, you can actually see. That is the main thing. So, this tells you how the atom has magnetic moment. So, atomic part is completed. Now, before we go to the solid, it is interesting to see what happens in the case of a molecule. I just take one or two simple examples just to show you the difference, especially what I mentioned earlier. I talked about hydrogen atom as a simplest case of paramagnetic atom, but I told you that hydrogen molecule is not. Then I also gave the example of oxygen atom and oxygen molecule both being paramagnetic. So, there is a slight apparent contradiction between the two. So, in the case of hydrogen, when hydrogen atom becomes two hydrogen atoms in the form of a molecule, the paramagnetism goes away and you get a diamagnetic. The same thing does not happen when two oxygen atoms pair up and becomes an oxygen molecule. Why is this difference? That is what is shown in this beautiful picture here. So, first thing you have to remember, you cannot explain magnetism of a molecule with the help of the atomic orbitals. We talked about atomic orbitals, 3D, 4D and other things are atomic orbitals. When you go to a molecule, that is not true. You have to bring in what is known as a molecular orbital. You must have studied in chemistry. You have to bring in molecular orbitals and see how the filling happens, again without violating the Pauli's principles and things like that. So, what happens in the case of hydrogen molecule? Hydrogen molecule is, I mean, hydrogen atom, let us start. This is one, just one electron in the 1s shell. Electronic configuration of hydrogen atom is 1s1. So, it has got a spin like this. It has got a magnetic moment of 1 Bohr magneton as we have seen earlier. Another identical hydrogen atom has the same thing. That is what is shown here. When these two things bond together to form the hydrogen molecule, H2 molecule, what is happening is that, I will not be able to go into the details of that in this limited time. So, you have two possibilities. What you have to construct is a molecular orbital using the atomic orbitals. That is the thing that is done in chemistry. So, you have two possibilities. You have a possibility of getting what is known as a bonding orbital, which is representing a stable molecule like what we know in the case of hydrogen molecule, or you can also get an anti-bonding molecule, which is something like an excited state. The ground state will be obviously this one, and this, to avoid violation of the Pauli's principle, when you have a bonding orbital and if you have to, now you have two electrons to be accommodated, both of them have to be accommodated here, and since the Pauli principle has to be kept in mind, they cannot be, both of them cannot be having the same spin up. That means this is ms half, this is ms half, that cannot be accepted here. So, you can accept a ms half and ms minus half, that is one is up and other thing is down. This net magnetic moment of this will be 0. So, this is why the atom, hydrogen atom is paramagnetic, whereas the hydrogen molecule is diamagnetic. Very simple, you bring in a bonding orbital and you see that diamagnetism has to be the only solution here. The question now is, why not this get extended for oxygen case? That is what is shown in the next one. In the case of oxygen, the number of electrons is more. So, you are molecular orbitals are little more complicated. Here again you have bonding and anti-bonding orbitals. You can see that these are the situations. You have 2s, 1s is not shown here. You have 2s, 2 electrons here. 2p, you have 4 electrons here. That corresponds to the one oxygen atom. Similarly, other oxygen atom here. Now, you bring in these two oxygen atoms. So, these two pair up here. Here it is paired up here. Then this is 2px. And 2PY and 2PZ. So, there are these two separated here. Now, if you bring in these two together to form oxygen molecule, what you see here is, this is the bonding orbital. Of course, it can take two, but it will be non-magnetic because they will cancel each other. Here also it will cancel each other. Here also again it is sigma, these are all called sigma bonds and pi bonds. This is a chemistry language, you must have gone through that. So this again will cancel each other. Here again you have pi orbitals of 2py and 2pz, again you can see they are cancelling each other. But now what is remaining? So how many you accommodated? 2, 2, 2. So there are 6 of them, 6, 8 and 10 are accommodated here. Then you have 2 more because each of them have 6 electrons each, 6 each. So you have to accommodate 12. So you have up to this you have come accommodated 10, and these 10 are actually not giving rise to any magnetic moment because they are completely cancelling each other. But you are left with 2 more. These 2 more have to be accommodated here only in the so called anti-bonding orbitals because they are all completely filled. When it goes here, these states, in fact here also, there is a degeneracy here. These 2 states, even though it is appearing as the same energy level, they correspond to 2 different orbitals. That means there is an orbital degeneracy here. So you can actually put 2 upspins here. In fact, you are doing it here also. See, there are 2 upspins and 2 downspins here because there is an orbital degeneracy of 2 here. Similarly, the same thing is happening here. There is an orbital degeneracy of 2 here. That means I can put 2 upspins here because orbital is anyway different. So there is no question of Pauli's principle being violated here. So I can put 2 upspins here, which means that here it is completely cancelled, here it is cancelled, here it is cancelled, this is also cancelled. Whereas here it is not cancelled because there is a degenerate state there, double degeneracy there, I can put them together. So this is what makes oxygen molecule magnetic, because there is an uncompensated moment coming from these 2 electrons which are occupying the anti-bonding pi orbitals shown here. There is no question of going here because you do not have those many electrons. Electrons are completely over by the time you reach here. So this is why oxygen molecule and oxygen atom, both of them are non-diamagnetic, they are paramagnetic. One can actually extend this argument to other molecules like nitrogen, same thing works. Nitrogen also one can show similar picture. The difference is, in the case of atoms to molecules, when you go, you have to really go and find out what is a molecular energy level scheme and try to accommodate the total number of electrons that are belonging to both the original atoms and try to accommodate them without violating the Pauli's principle after considering the degeneracies and see whether you are able to see some net magnetic moment. If you are able to see some net magnetic moment, that means it is going to be paramagnetic, otherwise it is diamagnetic. One case, the diamagnetic case is the one where it is hydrogen, and it is paramagnetic case when you have oxygen. That is the difference between the 2. Now next topic which we have to do, now we from atoms we have gone to molecules. The next thing obviously is to see what happens in the case of the solid state. So I think I will stop here. Maybe some questions if there are there, I can.
You have mentioned that paramagnetism exhibit due to the unpaired electrons in the inner cells.
Yeah.
Why it is so, sir? Why the inner cell unpaired electrons contribute to paramagnetism?
Yeah, only in unpaired electrons of the inner cells can contribute to paramagnetism, especially for a solid. Take the, as I mentioned, take the sodium example. So sodium has 281. 2 is a completely filled shell, 8 is a completely filled shell, 1 is the unpaired electron which is in the outermost shell. Suppose you are making a sodium solid. What is going to happen? This unpaired electron which is residing in the outermost shell, this is going to become a bond. This is going to bond with other electrons so that it becomes not an atom but it becomes a solid. So this is going to get paired up with other electrons. So effectively that will not be able to contribute to magnetism. Whereas if you are having these unpaired electrons in one of the inner shells like a 3D or 4F, it is not affected by bonding because bonding is all done by the outermost electron. No d electron will be involved in any bonding in any of these solids when the atoms are becoming solids. So as far as possible they should be unaffected, these electrons must be unaffected due to this process of bonding and so on. This can happen only if the electrons are in the inner shells. That is why the, in fact the higher, I mean the, if it is more and more to the core it is better. If you take 3D and 4F, I will tell a 4F is better choice than 3D because 4F is really unaffected by anything that is happening outside the atom. 3D is that way not that good because site, interference will be there. I am using a very colloquial language there. But as you go to inner and inner part of the core, And if you are able to see an unpaired electron there, it is much better as far as an intrinsic paramagnetic moment is concerned.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, how theoretically and practically be interpreted the magnetic susceptibility of materials?
Okay. Theoretically, we have done in some sense. I will complete for a solid. See, susceptibility you can define only for the solid. Susceptibility you don't talk about for an atom. Most of the thing I have been talking about for the atom. I will go to the solid very soon, as I told you. I mean, next lecture is on the solids. But idea is the same. You know, theoretically speaking, you find out what is the energy shift that is happening. From that, you can find out what is a magnetization response, and from that, I can actually do one more derivative with respect to the magnetic field. I can actually find out what is the susceptibility. So the general formalism I have shown you, that is nothing but a theoretical formalism of finding out what are the different susceptibilities. The first term, energy shift, is giving rise to the diamagnetic susceptibility finally, if I do a second derivative with respect to the magnetic field. Similarly, the energy shift due to the second term in the perturbation will give, if I do a second derivative with respect to the field, it will give me the susceptibility, the paramagnetic. This is as far as theory is concerned. Nothing more is needed. This is absolutely the fine theory as far as quantum mechanics is concerned. Nothing is assumed. It's all fine. Experimentally, I'll come to the details when I actually deal with the solids. But since you are asking, I will tell. So what you do is, susceptibility can be done two ways. There are certain instruments where you actually directly measure the susceptibility. You can measure the susceptibility straight away. Methods like the standard equipment is what is known as Faraday balance. Faraday balance is something which actually can give you the susceptibility of a paramagnetic material straight away. But these days, Faraday balance is not very often used. What one uses, you use a magnetometer. You use a magnetometer, but magnetometer can give you only the magnetic moment or the magnetization. If you know the volume of the material, you can convert the magnetic moment to magnetization. Then what you do is, you divide with the applied magnetic field, you can get a susceptibility, because it is chi is m by h, m by b in my terminology. So this is what is done. So there are two ways of finding out. One is directly, one is indirectly, as far as experimentally susceptibility measurement is concerned. I will show you some data next time.
While we talk about the bonding and antibonding orbitals,
yeah.
We know that antibonding orbitals belong to the virtual state. When we carry on the problems of molecules having more than 50 atoms, how to study the virtual state of that molecule, sir? Can you tell me, sir, how to study the virtual state?
Yeah. So, I have taken very simple examples of hydrogen and oxygen diatomic molecules, very easy. For molecules of this 50 and all, it is not this way. You have to do a proper theoretical treatment. These days a lot of packages are available. One can actually find out the energy scheme. There are many things available, chemistry people, I don't work on that, but I know that there are many packages available. You don't have to really be a theoretician to do that. So then you can actually find out how the filling happens. You need to know lot more things when you are molecule is complex. 50 atom is not a very small molecule. And you have to be very careful what kind of atoms you are going to have in that molecule. So a lot of things are there. So 50 is definitely not a thing that I am talking about. I was talking about the basic idea of finding out how the filling happens. That much only I have told you in this thing. For this one, my answer is that you have to identify what is the energy level scheme for such a molecule. You have to identify the ground state, and then you have to see how the various spin populations can be accommodated, how the filling happens, what are the degeneracies, because the lot of symmetry will be there in those molecules. There are other interactions. You are talking about a realistic molecule. There are other interactions like the ligand fields. Lot of issues have to be worried about. It depends on what kind of a molecule you have. I cannot give a general answer to that. Depending on the particular molecule, particular structure, what kind of a ligand that is there, what kind of magnetic ions are there, what kind of degeneracies are there for various levels, this will determine where your filling is going to end, and then you have to see whether it is going to give you a final net uncompensated moment. In that case, of course, it is going to be paramagnetic, otherwise no. So it is not a very simple question, but your question is very important. It has to be done essentially by a theoretical chemist.
In your previous lecture, you say that no any material is non-magnetic. My question is, how any liquid like a water molecule behaves when kept in uniform magnetic field? It means that what is the effect of magnetic field on the polarity of water molecule? Please tell.
So what I meant is, in my classification, I include diamagnetism also as one of the categories. When I do that, anything that you tell, any material that you tell is magnetic. Something will be diamagnetic, most of them actually, like the water that you are talking about, and some of them are paramagnetic at room temperature, some of them are ferromagnetic, some of them are anti-ferromagnetic, all these things. So what kind of a response this system has when the magnetic field is applied is the question. If a diamagnet is there, naturally there is a repulsion. If an attraction, definitely this is a ferromagnet. For example, if I take a magnet and put an iron piece, definitely there is an attraction because it is experiencing a positive effect. The response is positive. Whereas anything diamagnetic, in fact, the superconducting levitation that I am going to talk about, or Professor Ghosh is going to show, is a very extreme effect of diamagnetism, because there it is minus 1, but water, the susceptibility is much, much smaller. It is negative, but it is much smaller, nowhere near minus 1. So that is a difference. So somebody else also asked this question. I make it very clear, if you included a diamagnetism also into our categories, then everything is magnetic. I am repeating my statement. Many people do not do that, then they will tell, okay, this is magnetic, this is non-magnetic. In my language, there is nothing non-magnetic, everything is magnetic, maybe diamagnetic, that is fine, I do not worry about it.
My question is related with complex ions.
Okay.
Whose effective atomic mass is close to that of inert gases. So, what will be their behavior?
So, the magnetism is actually determined by whether you are going to have some unpaired electrons or not. If you are going to have unpaired electrons, definitely it must have at least some weak paramagnetic effect. If all the shells are completely filled, you can expect only diamagnetic effect. There is no question on that. So, depending on whatever system that you have to, it is very essential to find out what kind of electronic configuration you have for that particular atom. Atom is that way very good, because the interactions are very minimal. See, when you go to solid, it is other extreme, the interactions are very large, so many interactions. Gas that way is very good, I will be very happy to talk about the gas, but there are other issues, let us not worry about it. So gas, I can consider it as an atom which is completely non-interacting. So then it is very easy, you have to find out what kind of an electronic configuration it has got. That will simply determine what kind of magnetic response it will have. You talked about rare earths, that comparison is the other side, because rare earths are strongly paramagnetic, at least because they have unpaired electrons in 4F shell, 4F is very much inside. So they are not at all affected by the bonding and any kind of interactions this atom will have with the neighbors and other things. So whatever is there intrinsically will be protected, as in the case of an isolated rare earth atom. So rare earth solid and rare earth atom, as far as the atomic, the magnetic properties, especially the magnetic moment is concerned, there is not much of a difference, because this 4F shell of a solid is essentially similar to what happens in the case of an atom. There is no much effect of these external things. The bonding and other things are not going to affect the magnetic moment. So it is able to retain the atomic property considerably.
Yes, sir, some related question.
Yeah, please.
As we know that the body organs are supposed to be non-magnetic. If I made some material whose Z effective is equivalent to human tissue, so in that organ, if it may be artificial or biocompatible, what you call it is,
yeah,
can we have some treatment regarding that of magnetic material?
Yeah, your question is, yes. Yeah, no, I don't know whether I am answering exactly same thing what you are telling, but these days, for example, it is, I think I mentioned in the first lecture also, magnetic hyperthermia, which actually is used for cancer treatment. At least I know that, at least in rats and other animals, it is being tested. I don't know whether it is done in human beings at the moment. So what they do is, they use magnetic nanoparticles, locally they inject wherever the tumor or tissue is affected, and they actually use, I am going to talk about in the later lectures, what you use, you apply oscillating magnetic fields, so there is a heat, local heat produced, and this is able to cure the that part. So this is actually is a very important field in biomagnetism today. So not just for the drug delivery, this is actually the treatment itself. So this, you use magnetic particles, as you said, rightly said, it has to be biocompatible, you cannot inject anything into the body, it is very, very important. So once it is done, fortunately many of these ferrites are that way biocompatible, unfortunately the rarer things which are actually very good, but they are not biocompatible. There are very good magnetic systems, but they are not biocompatible. Ferrites are all right, so they are actually, they can be injected and locally they can produce a heat by having an external source outside. So this is being, I am sure, I know that definitely it is done in animals. It may happen to the human beings maybe in the near future if it is not done so far. So this is called a magnetic hyperthermia, it is a very important field today.
Yeah, I have a question. Can you just give some compare and contrast points or features between a permanent magnet and electromagnet, which is having same magnetic field B?
Okay.
Or magnetic field intensity B. Do they exhibit the same magnetic properties, or
I'm going to talk about
is
in
there
the,
any difference?
I'm going to talk about in the next coming lectures, but still I will mention it. Electromagnet, the problem is there is a limit. I mean, electromagnet, the magnetic field is determined by the current. When you apply current above certain thing, you are going to have the heating. So you have to have cooling arrangement, and it becomes extremely complicated, and it becomes very, very bulky. So today, the electromagnets typically produce, the highest is something like, if you put the best thing, it is something like 3 Tesla. That is 30 kilohertz is a field that can be produced by an electromagnet. Superconducting magnet can be used. Of course, it has got its own problem, that is a different thing, low temperature and other issues. Typically, even in our department, we can actually go to something like 9 Tesla, that is 90 kilohertz, without any problem. So, electromagnets can be used, provided your field requirements are something like 1 Tesla, 1.5 Tesla. Anything more than that, you have to depend on superconducting magnets only. There is no other way. Permanent magnets, yes, permanent magnets one can use, but again, it cannot be, I mean, my rough estimate is you cannot generate fields more than 3 Tesla in whatever configuration you are going to use, it is not possible. So higher field, definitely you have to depend on superconducting magnets only. I will be talking about in my superconductivity lecture later on.
I have one more question, sir.
Yeah, please.
As we know that oxygen is paramagnetic, is it possible to attract oxygen in atmosphere with the help of strong magnet?
Problem will be, as I mentioned, the susceptibility is very, very small. Paramagnetic susceptibility, like diamagnetic susceptibility, is very, very small. I have not thought about it, but I am sure the fields required will be very, very large. I don't know whether such a thing happens in the atmosphere, because I don't have any idea about the atmospheric sciences and so on. I'll look at it and tell you what kind of a field can actually make some attraction or something. But definitely, the susceptibilities are very, very small. So, only thing is that it is positive, that is the only thing, unlike the diamagnetic case, but otherwise it is very, very weak effect. But it is a good point, let me see whether something of that kind happens in the nature.
Okay, thank you, sir.